Fancy. I'm Matthias Goldman. I'm from the University of Frankfurt. And at the moment, I'm a guest at Collegio Carlo Alberto and also at the Universitat di Torino. That's how I met Ugo Mattei, who was kind enough to invite me here to talk to you at this seminar. And I would like to take the opportunity to share a few thoughts with you about the relationship between law and finance, and especially public law and finance. I guess that here are a lot of people who understand themselves as private lawyers, but I think that at the end of the day, we will encounter similar problems to your that in the field. Now, what are the problems that I'm talking about? I'm talking here about, as you can read from the title, the history of misunderstandings. And I'm also trying to make a proposal. What are misunderstandings? What is my research interest? Let me tell you two anecdotes. The first anecdote dates from 2012. I was sitting in the German Ministry of Finance. Now, this is a very scary building and a very intimidating building. Very large, big halls, and people tend to be somewhat shy, obviously. Nevertheless, at this meeting, which was about the European debt crisis, we have a fierce controversy among many people present at that meeting, mostly economists, about the right way to solve the Eurozone debt crisis. And many highly diverse models being debated. But I was struck that people agreed on one particular thing. All of them agreed that Article 125 of the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, the no bailout clause, had been violated. All of them agreed. Lest the fact that only a few days earlier, the European Court of Justice had rendered a Springer judgment in which it said that Article 125 of the EU had not been violated.
So tell us what Article 125 says.
125 is the no bailout clause. It basically says that states should not, like member states and the European Union, it says do not assume the debt of other member states. It says, it does not say that they should not assume the debt, but it says they do not assume the debt of other states. And then the question is, can you interpret and, let me say, stretch that provision in a way that makes it possible to say that all the bailout measures taken in the aftermath of the sovereign debt crisis, EFSF, ESM, and all the different acronyms, which basically consist in the European Union or a special vehicle or the member states extending credit to troubled member states, whether these mechanisms are acceptable under that provision or whether they violate the no bailout clause. So that's the question. How far can you stretch it? And all economists agreed that provision was violated. That provision was a red line that was specifically established or stipulated to prevent such kind of mechanisms. And the European Court of Justice at the same time says, no, it's not a violation. We have to understand the Eurozone as a living instrument. Law is something that is not as rigid as you assume. Law is something that might develop over time and adapt to the situation. And if the purpose of all these bailout mechanisms, all of this fresh credit, is to ensure, so to say, the survival of the Eurozone and to return to a policy of stability, then it's okay. And this rule doesn't, these mechanisms don't violate Article 125. And that means that they have a much more, let me say, flexible or amenable understanding of the law. We're talking about one and the same text here. So how far can you stretch that text? So that's the question. How does this text develop over time? Is it a strict rule that remains the same once and forever? Do you always have to go back to the history? And is that the ultimate thing that can be said about that rule? Or does the rule change as we change?
So what was the purpose of the introduction of the rule to begin with?
when they did it.
Yeah.
The purpose of, yeah, that's a good question, but the purpose of 125 is that there should be a stability union. And but the question is, what do you do in a crisis, so to say? Do you insist in the crisis on a rule that is principally made for good times and that is made to prevent such a crisis? What happens, so to say, to a rule that is meant to prevent a crisis when the crisis that was never supposed to happen happens? Do you still drag on and like stubbornly insist that no, this shouldn't be the case? We have this poem of Christian Morgenstern, which is well known in Germany, where it says, you know, what should not be must not be, or can you somehow force the facts to comply with norms? Sometimes it's difficult because the facts are just there, and it's difficult to get beyond a fact like a major crisis, and then you have to look at the rule and maybe to rethink it. That's exactly what the court did, but it was actually against the expectation of everybody that had thought about this rule in the discipline of economics. And I'm talking here about really major thinkers in the field of economics, or not, like big names in the field of monetary and public finance. Yeah. So that is my first initial with that, because I think that this place is great. Well, sorry, I'm trying to switch off the noise a little bit. That illustrates already a little bit my purpose. I'm talking here about, so to say, the interrelationship between the law and its flexibility, and on the other hand, the expectations of the economic discipline, or economics as a discipline, and that very often informs political proposals that actually become the written law. And then the law does something which they don't expect to do. That is somehow, you know, the conflict that we have. So we are dealing here with different traffic rules. That's what you would say. Is law a red line, or is law more amenable? And that somehow should be my outline. That looks a bit shocking, but I think some of these points will go rather quickly. So after this introduction, I will try to illustrate what I consider as the main problem behind these rules. And that's the problem of immanence and differentiation. Well, that sounds complicated at first. I'll explain what I mean by that. And I will theorize that in part C. I will develop my own proposal and apply my own proposal. That's basically the outline. Now let me go right to that problem. Immanence and differentiation. What do I mean by these two problems? I'll illustrate them with three cases. But first, let me explain what I mean by that. I'm talking about the relationship between law and economics. And I think that the relationship between law and economics suffers from a problem of immanence and a problem of differentiation. Now, immanence, you could also say solipsism, basically refers to a foundational problem of modernity. Modernity is based on methodological individualism. Cogito ergo sum. That's Cartesius and discovered, and it means that any knowledge, every understanding that we have is based on your own individual subjective knowledge. And that sometimes makes it difficult to transfer knowledge from one individual to another individual, or from one discipline to another discipline. So you're somehow self-sufficient. You think you are autonomous. And that somehow also, that is the foundation of your knowledge, but it is also a limitation of your knowledge. That's immanence. And differentiation is more or less the flip side of immanence. Now, if every individual has their own worldview, so to say, and their own concepts of knowledge, then if two individuals try to converse, they might run into misunderstandings. They might not understand each other, because each of them has their own proper worldview. And the only way to develop knowledge is by your own capacity of reason. And since our capacities of reason are different and framed by different experiences, we sometimes don't understand each other. That's differentiation. The world is functionally differentiated into different fields. And sometimes there is an economic field and a legal field. Each of them follows their own rationality. So each of them is somehow immanent in its own reasoning, but faces trouble to connect with the other. That's the problem of differentiation. It's a fundamental characteristic of our modernity, of our modern presence, and I think it's also something that you can find in the field of finance. And now let me go to these cases. Now let me illustrate what it means to...
Can we interrupt when you talk?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. So now I have, I'd like you to give a little bit more of some thought about this, how why you qualify as immanence, this sort of solipsism.
Yeah.
Because in the whole kind of political economic view, immanence would be opposed to transcendence. Transcendence being an abstraction, a universal abstraction, whereas immanence would be basically the material conditions in which knowledge arises. So immanence, at least in someone who is from a Marxist perspective, would be very different from the idea of from the idea of methodological individualism you're talking about.
Okay, yes. so we have a methodological
understanding. Yeah,
exactly. Thanks for what you meant about that's very important. So I should probably be careful. With the notion of immanence.
I would say individualism versus
individualism. Yeah. Immanence is a terminology that you sometimes find in, and I found it in theology.
Okay.
But not in the sense of, you know, the difference to metaphysics, but also it has to do with the problem. Do you find your own approach to God, and what's the relationship to the community, so to say, to the congregation, between the individual and the congregation? And so in there, I found a lot of humanity, you could also say, autonomy, individualism, methodological individualism.
Yeah, autonomy would be less problematic, yeah.
I wonder, I find the concept is very interesting, but I wonder, because when I hear the phenomenon explained, I think of the problems of professionalization.
Yeah.
And I wonder how much is that very similar or dissimilar to what you're describing here, and why you didn't choose to use this other terminology. What do you think you gain from using these other concepts?
And what I gain by using these two concepts?
Rather than professionalization.
No, I think it's not just professionalization. I think professionalization is a part of differentiation. I think differentiation, professionalization refers to, you know, the division of labor.
Yeah.
And but the division of labor is, professionalization and the division of labor are parts of larger functional differentiation in society, which goes beyond the field of labor. So we have got, since everybody, so to say, can have their own worldview, you have got different, Luhmann says, systems of thought and of operation, which basically pervade all our lives, not just the field of labor and not just our professional lives. So even in the field of faith, or even in the field of personal relationships, you would find different rationalities at work, so to say, that clash with each other. So the rationalities of your private life might collide with the rationalities of your professional life. That would also be a problem of differentiation. And not just, you know, different professional mindsets. So it's a bit larger problem.
So you're hinting, when these professional topics are being discussed, also the individual idiosyncrasies are also coming into the play of how it is.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. You have a lot of individual idiosyncrasies, and that leads to problems of misunderstandings, or the problems of getting into communication. Now, let me just illustrate that, how I think that it plays out. Whenever you look at certain cases in the Eurozone crisis, I think you can discern one or both of these problems. Just because all these cases are somewhere at the crossroads of law and economics. Now, we have had in the past 15, 20 years a lot of sovereign debt litigation. And litigation might hold out creditors. What do I mean by that? Now we know now that states can get insolvent. And when the state gets insolvent, what do? They try to restructure their debt exchange old debt against new debt. And leaving a lot of details apart, normally for that you really have to rely to a certain extent on the voluntary cooperation of your creditors. Now some creditors think they're smarter than the others, and they refuse to participate in this exchange of old debt against new debt. And the new debt, you know, has more favorable conditions. It has a lower interest rate, and it has sometimes a lower nominal value, and so on. So it's not so advantageous for each individual creditor, but collectively, it enables everybody at least to get a certain return on their credit. So collectively, it's a good thing. And some creditors say they're smarter than the others. They don't participate in that exchange. That's a holdout. And what do they do to get their money? They sue. They sue, they go to the court. And immunities are not a problem anymore. We've got broad waivers and also customary recognition of that this is not the case for sovereign immunity. So you can sue. Now, when courts decide these cases, you can understand a problem of, or you can discern a problem of immanence in the legal discipline. You could also say legal autonomy, a certain insensitivity for the whole picture, for the economic and political picture. Because the court looks at the case and says, well, first of all, this is a debt instrument, this is a contract. Something is owed under that contract. Any change to that contract is a matter of voluntary consent. And even if, and that's the crucial point, even if we do not, or the creditor in this case, in this individual case, does not participate in this exchange, in this restructuring, the state will not go bankrupt. So they take the perspective of the case which they are supposed to decide. They say, well, you know, 75% of all creditors participated in the restructuring, so there's no need not to pay the remaining 25% what is owed to them under the old debt. Of course, this is a big problem from a more holistic perspective, because you know, what incentive do creditors have to participate in such a restructuring if you can get away with this free riding? It's a problem of free riding, it's a problem of collective action. But since courts only see the individual case, it's structurally difficult, or it has proven structurally difficult to make courts take the public interest issue seriously and somehow get a holistic perspective. Courts are deciding one individual case according to the law. They're not economists legislating. Yeah? So there's a problem of immanence, so to say, in the decision of the decision maker. Let me go to the second example, differentiation. Now, I think I'll stick to the well-known conflict or well-known issue surrounding the ECB's unconventional monetary policies. Now, are you familiar with this issue, or should I introduce you? No problem. No, you know that we had this Eurozone debt crisis, and the states wanted to support those sovereign states a lot by giving them fiscal support, by giving them credit. Nevertheless, it was not enough. The markets didn't believe the story, and the situation became more and more tense in the year 2012, about, until Mario Draghi made the same speech at the ECB, saying, we will intervene in the market and buy sovereign debt, whatever it takes. And that stopped the trouble, because then people knew that the ECB would like constantly purchase sovereign debt instruments and extend its monetary base in countries. Now the problem is that it says in the statute, or in the European treaties, in Article 127, that the ECB should always ensure price stability. That is somehow the... And if you extend your monetary base, if you purchase sovereign debt by unlimited volumes, you would potentially risk price stability. Because how does the ECB purchase sovereign debt? What do they give to someone in exchange? They want to have sovereign debt from, let's say, the state community or someone who has Italian sovereign bonds. What do they give them? What do they give in exchange? Someone said?
It's cash.
Cash, exactly cash. Where do they get the cash from?
They
actually produce it themselves. So they produce it themselves, and that is potentially a risk for an economic for price stability, because once you print too much money, prices will go up. Prices are always the result of the relationship between the goods and you know, the quantity of goods and the quantity of money. That's somehow that you need to put in the relation.
What IMT means?
It means outright monetary transactions. It's a complicated technical term that has no meaning that anybody needs to
understand.
Understood?
It means cash.
It means cash. Yeah, it's a euphemism. Outright monetary transaction. I mean, whenever the ECB is extending its monetary base, it normally does so through monetary transactions. Of course. It has to sell or buy anything from somebody who wants to have cash. That's a monetary transaction. And to make them outright means to make them immediately and to really purchase it and take it on their books. Yeah. Not as loans, but as purchase.
And SSM is the what SSM means?
SSM I haven't spoken about. That would be the second example. I think in the interest of time, I'm skipping that here. That's the single supervisory mechanism. Then we have also similar problems where there's economic rationality on the one hand and there's a legal rationality on the other hand. So what is the problem of differentiation which we have here? Now, on the one hand, there's price stability. This is a clear, so the second example, yeah. This is a clear economic concept. It's being developed, established. On the other hand, there is the somehow legal or political, let's say political rationality to keep the Eurozone together. And clashes here in a way that has no easy answer. So again, there is a clash of different rationalities. How far, so to say, can you risk price stability to maintain the integrity of the Eurozone and to prevent that it is the victim of market disturbances and of a market that has lost the trust in it.
Perhaps it's also a higher economic rationality.
Yeah, sometimes to a certain extent you can read it into an economic rationality, but that probably would require a different concept for price stability. Mm-hmm. Price stability is not understood in that way, normally.
I'm saying when they decide in what we interpret as the public interest of keeping the union together, one could also interpret that as a higher economic interest, a higher long-term view of keeping these markets together.
The conflict is the problem here is it seems to me that there is what you're talking about long-term economic interest would be the idea of sovereignty, right? So the decision whether to keep together Europe is a sovereign decision. The central bank really doesn't have monetary sovereignty, whereas it looks like it's exercising it de facto, right? Because, I mean, that's the difference between the European Central Bank and the Federal Reserve, is that the European Central Bank is actually stuck in the idea of economic stability and inflationary fight. And so that seems to me that there is a tension, right?
Exactly. One has also to take into consideration what the purpose is of the European Central Bank.
Yeah.
The European Central Bank is a central bank. It's not a policymaker. So to say, it was not intended and it is not equipped to make high-scale political decisions. It is there to watch price stability. Its mandate says price stability. Of course, there's different ways of understanding price stability, and we will come to that. Nevertheless, this long-term perspective, which you're talking about, somehow includes at least a political rationality. Yeah? Something it's the idea that we can risk price stability for a higher good. And that goes, at least it stretches the mandate. The ECB, of course, has its own justification for its policy. It said we need that in order to make our policy effective. There are a lot of technical ramifications to that. I don't really need to go into that. Here, it suffices to show that there is a political dimension, stability of the Eurozone, and an economic dimension, price stability, and both of them are somehow in a conflict. And that is basically what this whole dispute and the many courts, court decisions that we have on it are about. Now, the third thing is about imminence and differentiation. And that concerns the Eurozone bailouts, what I have mentioned already, this Article 125 problem. Now, can we bail out or not, and under which conditions? And also here we have got a problem of imminence and of differentiation. Now, the problem of imminence is somehow, if you look at the question of bailout from an economic perspective, what huge risk do you run if you insist that there should be no bailout? That Article 125, which says states do not assume the debt of other states, should be observed to the letter, without exception, without any flexibility, like the red stop sign. What rationality, so to say, is behind that? Imagine whenever a state goes bankrupt, they get a lot of money to be bailed out. What would that state do? Imagine you're a politician, you're a prime minister of that state, and you face the question whether you want to spend more or you want to spend less. What would you do?
Spend more.
Obviously, spend more. So there's a risk of moral hazard. That's how this is called in a technical sense. There is a risk of abuse, so to say. People might be inclined to abuse the generosity of those who bail them out. And to prevent that is the purpose of that Article 125. It does not consider, and that's a problem of differentiation, and so you see also how those two are related. What effects that insistence on a no bailout would have for the state in question? Not only for the integrity of the Eurozone, but also for the people. If the state needs to cut back and cut back and cut back and cut back, first of all, it might not always be economically rationally, because you can also save yourself to death. Yeah, you can starve yourself to death. A public budget is not like a private household. If a private household spends some money, the money is gone. And if the public purse spends some money, the money is still there. It's just in someone else's hands, who might also do useful things with it. First of all, you might starve yourself to death. That's still an economic rationality, but then there's a non-economic rationality, human rights. And something like welfare concerns. Yeah? If you close schools, if you close higher education, if you close public swimming pools, if you close essential public services, like cleaning the streets, at a certain point you really get into trouble, and you really get to a very low level of human rights enjoyment in the sense of, imagine human rights are not just political rights, but also economic, social, and cultural rights. Yeah. So something like right to health, right to adequate social security are being threatened if you cut too much. And that's a different rationality. It's a rationality that's again, not economic. I take it that there is a relationship, of course, both are closely related, but it takes a further political step. So, moral hazard, something the internal economic perspective, collides with a larger human rights perspective. So that's both problems in combination.
It has a lot to do with the international, the geopolitical situation, right? Because when if the public debt is actually taken by the state against its own citizens, then the interest rate is spent in the local economy. And that is something that makes it sustainable, because it is true that you are very much in debt, but as you said before, the money that you are, the interest that you're paying on the debt are spent strengthen the economy locally and therefore are taking care of the kind of necessities we are talking about. But the problem arises when most of the sovereign debt is not in the spend, it's not internal, it's all externally.
Interest.
Then you're paying interest rates and therefore you're drawing money again from the economy into the global. And there is where the problems arise. So in a way it's a self-enforcing prophecy.
I mean, it's a big question to what extent you can replace public investments by private investments. Is that?
Yeah.
Of course, yeah. That's
the basic case. Basic case, Keynesian ideas. Right?
Yeah.
And the reason I brought the point I did before of the ultimately an economic rationality as well is because I can draw from my own experience at home and I can see how the ultimate goal is no matter what the repayment and what is happening is to the cost of human rights.
This is very good. I'm very grateful for these comments because it really shows that we have also disputes about economic concerns. So some of the terms or of the concepts included in the European treaties, such as the no bailout clause, you see that they are based on a particular economic theory. Mostly, yeah, it's the theories of neoliberalism. If you look at it in the history of economics, you can see that this has quite a specific pedigree, so to say. And of course, there's also controversy in economics about that. And the question is, what do you do with this controversy in economics if you have to decide a legal case? So that is just to add another level of complexity. I was deliberately, I shouldn't have done so probably, but I was trying to keep it a little bit simple, but that is actually the problem. We have on both sides here, we have highly contested concepts, law and economics, and both of them collide. Yeah, we have debates in economics about what is the right way regarding public investments or monetary policy, and in the law we have got debates about political or traditional activism versus a stricter, more historical, more originalist view, and all different sorts of legal theories that compete with each other, and they collide. And that is basically what I wanted to do with theorizing immanence and differentiation. To add just another level of complexity. Now, we not only do we have complex debates in economics and complex debates in the law about what the law is. I don't really need to rehash that here. I think everybody knows that there is a big disagreement about what the law is. Do we follow a critical view of the law? Do we follow a strict positivist, any kind of inclusive positivist idea of the law? Do we follow a hermeneutic, discourse-theoretical concept of the law? Depending on that, you might get to different results if you solve the case. And it's the same with economics. If you follow Keynes or if you follow Hayek, you will get different results. Now, the particular additional problem that I want to mention is that we have got specific ideas of law in economics, and we've got specific ideas of economics in law, which don't necessarily reflect the full complexity of the other field. My observation, and that is up for debate, my observation is that in the economic literature that I was looking at, the idea of the law is normally a mechanical one. Law is something that is a tool to achieve a certain end, and it works with precision. Hence the irritation of all these economists in the German Ministry of Finance about that decision of the European Court of Justice. It was classified as obviously political. But if you look at the decision of the European Court of Justice, where it said that this no bailout rule, Article 125, had not been violated, it's not political at all. They make an argument, a historic argument. They say, well, this was the historical understanding. Then they go on and they make a systematic argument. Then they make a purposive argument. And that is what trumps their reasoning. But they make a legal argument which follows really the canonicities of legal interpretation that we all have cherished. So it's very, very difficult to say that this is a political, outrageous judgment. Of course, we can disagree with it. But it is a legal and a reasonable legal argument. And we can reasonably disagree on the law. And that, in my understanding, is not always fully considered in economics. Just imagine that we had a debate in economics of, which is still ongoing, about rules versus discretion. Should you give discretion to the administration, or should the administration and the government be bound by rules? This whole debate, which has produced an avalanche of literature over the last 20, 30 years, never really considered the indeterminacy of the law and the contingency which is in the law. It was, and that rules are strict was somehow taken for granted. And so there are problems in each discipline. I don't think that the law is different when we talk about economics. And so I think there are problems in each discipline to recognize the contingency and the complexity of the other discipline. Yeah.
Yeah, but there are dominant approaches though.
Yeah.
Both. I mean, one thing is to be, you know, a sophisticated theoretical observer of the reality, which would say, oh, of course, you know, there is the ordo-liberal inspiration of the European treatises, there is neoliberalism, but also there is, you know, Keynes, and there is Marx, and there is, you know, a much more complex thing. And similarly, that you said in the law, you know, there is formalism, there is realism, there is this, this, and that. That's one thing. The other thing is that the truth of the matter, the kind of issue you're talking about, there are dominant visions that are those that are politically dominant in a given moment, which in economics is certainly right now still, you know, microeconomic orthodoxy based on some sort of crypto private ideas of austerity and self-restraint and equilibrium and all of that. And in law there is this idea that the law is actually the product of the legislature that binds in a formalistic way. So there are these dominant visions that clash with each other.
I think the interesting thing you're saying is
that there are two dominant visions, one in economics, one in law, that you're saying they conflict. In fact, it seems to me that it would be an interesting observation in seeing how, in spite of what we call as, the opposite of immanence, you call this
differentiation. Yeah.
That in spite of theoretical differentiation, there is actually a very strong converging path in making legal rationality becoming like economic rationality. So the differentiation is in some ways cured by the fact that the power is unitary.
I wouldn't know which concept of law is on that. I honestly wouldn't know.
Yeah.
I would, like, from a legal theory perspective, I wouldn't know. We know there's like this practical way of running through, and that's probably the dominant approach, I would say.
Mm.
But whether that corresponds to any particular theoretical school, I wouldn't know. I would say, like, I'm not sure.
I was just wondering, I'm thinking out loud. Don't we think these two projects are very different projects at the core? Thinking of the law as a social project of creating a society and keeping that society together based on certain beliefs, versus the project of neoliberal economics, which is about efficient production and rewarding the individuals who they believe contribute the most to that efficient production. So these are very different things.
Yeah.
So when one takes over the other, especially when neoliberal economics takes over the other, that engine in society that the law could be of keeping the society together will destroy that aspect. I don't know.
Yeah, okay. The problem is that, I mean, when you put law and economics together, of course you have got these highly diverging approaches with highly different consequences and rationalities. Nevertheless, law is just a law. In law it says, it doesn't say, well, always interpret this law in the sense of neoliberal or the classic economics. That's what the job is like, so to say. So how amenable, so to say, is law to changes in or to conflicts and controversies in the field of economics? Or is it tied to that at all? Shouldn't it follow also political rationality?
But yeah, what I'm trying to argue is that I'm not a lawyer, but looking from outside, how the things are looking, I think it shouldn't be, because it has, the law has a different purpose as the economics discipline does.
It's autonomy. That's our unit, it's our autonomy.
Yeah, yeah, that's true, but it's also true that I don't think that it is realistic to think that these two domains that are the product of humanness kind of live together in some sort of separated but equal way. There is a constant attempt to take over, or one over the two, according to different historical moments. So in the 70s, there was clearly a constant takeover approach of, say, the social rights over the economic rationality, because it was a moment of strong political agency. Whereas now, there is the opposite dynamic. And that seems to me that is highly relevant in your analysis, you know, trying to put it dynamic in the sense that is an unstable relationship that is contested and changes quite a bit over time.
That's of course we should be mindful of power structures that I completely agree. And I think it what I said here is somehow the theoretical groundwork that enables these problems of domination. That result eventually from the fact that both law and economics are somehow contested and indeterminate and changing and evolving. Yeah. And of course, as it evolves, different vested interests might try to take over either one discipline or the other. And so I don't want to be naive about powers behind it. The only thing that I say is that it must not be necessarily as it is. There is no way to claim that one view is really the right one.
Yeah.
We have got divergent rationalities within both fields, and they sometimes collide.
Yeah, but another thing that I would point out that I think it might be useful for the sake of making your argument more robust is that this stereotype view, so that in other words, the economist would look at the lawyer and say, "Oh, these guys are kind of black letterish." Region, so this narrative about the law of the economist might be due to misunderstanding, but might also be a strategy of political domination. Like, if you look at the World Bank doing business reports, for example, they start saying, those people in the Global South or in France, they are formalistic, and therefore they don't understand the way in which things should be. It's a way to create a stereotype on the lawyer as being some sort of black-lettership idiot that doesn't work in the complexity of the global world or something. So that may be then a strategy, And vice versa, from the lawyer's perspective, it might be a strategy to say all economists are neoliberal in order to deploy strategies of resistance or strategy to defend certain kind of others' local interests and so on and so forth. So it's a very dynamic struggle of power that is also based on misrepresentation of the others that might not necessarily be genuine or might not necessarily be in good faith. It might be a strategy itself. So there are both the aspects, it seems to me.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Could I say something? Because I think that strategy works.
Yeah.
Because you have on one side a very clear identity of what the goal is and what it means to be this identity, the economist side. And on the law side, you have perhaps I'm not saying in a positive or negative way, but not that clarity of identity. And therefore, you are in a more questioning yourself, should I take this or not, and so on. Because the clarity of, from a law point of view, what is it that you are to deliver when you are confronted with this very strong identity is not established. I don't know if I explain myself well, but I think this is what allows and makes more powerful the other ideology to come over and co-opt. And
because the lawyer starts with sovereignty. You see, the lawyer has a strong identity as long as he can say, I function with this a sovereign vertical structure or something. And then the lawyer develops a strong identity. The Italian lawyer, the Greek lawyer, the German lawyer, develops that identity within a very national structure, because that is where the project of modernity was born. You know, the Westphalian state, the borders, the concentration of power, and all of that. The reality of capitalism, of course, is different. You know, it's global, it's broader, and you need a different rationality to understand it. And where it becomes kicks in with an identity that is much less connected to, you know, local borders and much more connected to forces of capital transformation. And this is why, you know, in dynamics such as the building of Europe, which is clearly something that doesn't work with a clear idea of sovereignty, because nobody knows whether the sovereignty is in Germany, whether the sovereignty is in Brussels, whether the sovereignty is at Goldman Sachs. You know, nobody knows where the sovereignty is in Europe at this moment. And therefore, the lawyers are completely kind of outspaced by not understanding where their sovereignty is. Who is the king I have to serve? Where is he? You know? Where is my master? Don't know. Whereas the economist is not used, it has the master very clearly, capital accumulation, and therefore his purpose is at ease. You know, this is, seems to me that is the context of this transformation.
Or not just capital, but also the whole economy.
Yeah, the rationality.
And that somehow clashes also with the idea of law. And so that very often for them, any legal argument just seems to be the argument of the homo economicus.
Yeah.
And it's also of rationally interested in people. And that is a way of doing away with legal arguments, even though they might really relate to the structure, to the history, or to the purpose of the law. They just say, you know, it's self-interested arguments, basically. And that is basically the end of any legal argument. That doesn't make really that. I think I need to hurry up a little bit. So, here, no, this is the problem that we have. We can admire this problem, and I would hope at least to find agreement on this problem. And I know that I will find significantly less agreement on the solution I'm going to propose. Because my solution is a bit, you know, if you go to solutions, you somehow have to somehow open your jacket or your pants and show what is really there and what you really believe in. And what I believe in is, I don't believe in, but what I think is useful for managing this problem is discourse theory. So, Habermas' idea of the law. What is the idea behind it? Understanding law as discourse. Now, law is created through discourse in parliaments, but also the application of the law is, for Habermas, a form of discourse. It's a form of a structured debate which has, and this is important, which has no materially, substantively correct solution. The only solution in a legal dispute or in a legal argument that is correct is the one which has emerged as the consequence of a correct procedure. And a correct exchange of, or correct in the sense of complete and coherent exchange or an argumentation. It needs to be complete in that it considers the relevant case law and tries to make a coherent argument, knowing that you can disagree on coherence, on rationality. So it's somehow so the right solution for Habermas is as good as it gets. It's procedurally right. It's a procedurally refined solution, and that relies in essential to an essential extent on principles, because principles are the elements in the legal system which provide for coherence. Now that sounds very Lockeanian, and Habermas owes a lot to Lockean, but there's no difference. That Habermas says that principles are not what the judge thinks that principles are, that also these principles are subject to discourse and to deliberation. Yeah, so he has a less solipsistic idea of principles. And we have to somehow justify the existence of a principle by reference to the law, by showing that this principle really is something that you can find in the law as a deep structure in the law. That's one element which somehow justifies legal argument. And the other element is democratic legitimacy. Yeah. So, since we can disagree on substance, judges always need to be, or decision makers, need to have a level of democratic quadratic legitimacy, which is commensurate to the significance of their decision. And how can you use that in order to find a better relationship between legal debate and economic debate? How to open and close the discourse for economics or economic argument? That would be my second point. I think the key is really that we need to connect the two at the level of principles. That means simply that lawyers can adopt principles that they take from economics, but from there they need to make a proper legal argument, so to say. And understand law as an autonomous discourse that is open for all other professionalities which are proper to the law, like human rights, like public interests. Yeah? So we can connect at the level of principles, but we should not, so to say, have economics dictated with the decisions. It's almost it's almost trivial, I know, but I'm trying to develop really rules of thumb here. I don't want to make magics, but some rules of thumb that can be applied in practice. So let's connect law and economics at a level of principles. And the second rule of thumb is that you somehow need to balance expertise, economic expertise, and democratic legitimacy. The more democratically legitimate some expertise is, the more deference you can give to it. Yeah? So if some expertise is just a scholar's opinion, it has very little democratic legitimacy. And courts have all reason to have a debate about that and to see how contingent that opinion might be. So you need to, and this concept of procedural law, you need to hear a lot of. How accepted is that view? Is there a divergent view? Is there a difference of opinions? And to get the full picture, so to say. Yeah. And also to look for developments in that discipline. Yeah. On the other hand, if there is a decision maker, especially a governmental institution with a high level of democratic legitimacy, it's easier to defer to them. So that's again a rule of thumb, yeah? Just as much as I can.
I think this idea of connecting at the level of principles might work, but itself is very complicated because what are, for example, let's talk about German law today. What are the principles of the German legal system? Where are you going to look for them? Are you going to look for them in the German constitution, which is a social constitution with a certain kind of theory of property, with a certain kind of ideas of second generation rights? And those are all kind of some principles that evolved after the liberal phase, in the construction of the democratic Germany. Or are the principles in the European treaties that are, all neoliberal or liberalism? So there is a tension there.
It depends on the case. Whatever the governing law has said, I think the principle main places where you find principles are two. The one is the constitutional order, which is called upon to make a decision, or under which you are making your decision. So that would be either the German constitution, or the Italian constitution, or the European treaties, depending on which court is decided. Or the UN Charter, if it's, the regime of the World Bank, if it's an investment fund, or UN
system. But if you're a judge, say that you are
a judge. The second area where you get your principles from is the specific law in question, so the material law, which you, I think, have to understand not just as a collection of individual rules, but as something like a structure.
Yeah.
So that might be, for example, the law related to sovereign debt. That might be contract law. Contract law has its own specific principles. I don't need to tell that here. There would be always to Athens. If the case is about contracts, then contract law, of course, is a rich source of principles that you somehow have to.
Yeah. The problem is that the very same Fondal case. Mm-hmm. Might occur in an ordinary civil court in Baden-Baden,
yeah.
Or might occur in here, and then you have the judge there with a holdout case that has certain, if he makes the principles of the German social constitution apply, he might decide in a certain way. Whereas if he makes the principles of neoliberalism apply, might decide in another way, right?
This is
where the issue of the principles, because the principles are variable themselves.
You would not get complete uniformity. We would only get uniformity if we could wish away the problem of differentiation and autonomy. As long as we have these problems, we will never get uniformity. All we can get is certain ways of managing those conflicts in a way that it does not deeply disrupt our economic, legal, and political structures. So I would be glad if the courts in Baden-Baden and courts in Torino all were aware of the need to reflect on the principles applicable to this case in a large sense, and not just the principles of contract law, but also the constitutional principles. And also to consider, what one or the other economist wrote about these principles in their own rationality. Yeah? So connect that with the economic picture. If we are there, I would already be greatly relieved. And then courts might still disagree, but then at least we are on the same page. And we are not there yet. And that is basically where I want us to go. So just to, one second, yeah, just to go, I mean, that is basically what I wanted to say on the issue of holdout litigation. So you have to somehow bring that to a principled level and consider diverging principles which play a role here. Yeah, just two. You can name more principles. So one of them is debt sustainability, which is nowadays a principle recognized under the IMF regime. That's somehow, and it's also a legal term in the IMF legal framework, but one with a clear economic underpinning. On the other hand, there are of course principles from contract law, like facta sunt servanda, and you somehow have to have a decision that takes into account the diverging principles.
But Google, I was thinking, don't you think that ultimately that judge in Baden-Baden has to apply the supranational principles of the union? Because
that's not what the constitutional court in Germany.
I know, but if you look at the power distribution.
No, but they don't have to do so. For example, if they are applying union law as a necessary preliminary question to the constitutional question which they're supposed to solve, then they will also have to apply principles of the European treaties. Like the OIT case here, so for the constitutional court, the question is, did the EU exceed its powers? In order to find that out, they necessarily need to take into consideration principles under European treaties, like price stability. And another principle, which has been found by the European Court of Justice, is integrity of the Eurozone. And this is a non-economic principle. Yeah? And so here you have to somehow connect economic, legal, political principles, ideas, and make sure that you have a well-rounded view of each of them. And also that you, for example, have entered into a debate about price stability. So that would be the second rule of thumb. Just don't blindly follow what anyone tells you about price stability. Try to make up your mind. Well, there's the ECB, which is a relatively legitimate institution, although that could be improved. So if they say that this is their approach to price stability, you can give some deference to them, but still see what concepts of price stability they are, and if they make a reasonable argument, under a discursive reasonable argument, then you might defer to them.
Yeah, but then there are, easy to go back to what you were saying, there are principles that are much deeper, like, principles such as human dignity.
Yeah.
Okay? Which is, informs the German constitution and the Italian constitution. So human dignity is a principle that seems to me is an element that is deeper on both price stability and integrity of the Eurozone, because it is about the possibility of survival of basic human needs. Okay? So these are also principles that might not be in the higher order, in the sense of the hierarchy of construction of the legal building, they might be at much more lower level because they are at the level of local states or even of local communities, but possibly in a more purposeful view of the law and in general of the polity, you know, they should prevail. And in fact, that was the German Constitutional Court said at that point, right? That human dignity is not something that can be given out for the purpose of being in Europe or for the purpose of being, you know, determining an economic order. So that's another problem with the idea of principles, at what level you grant the principles.
That's true. Because although they would, you know, human dignity, they would say, is only effective in very grave cases. So if you have to go very, very far to say that governmental power or the power of a private person be effective.
In Greece, it's happening. You know, people are struggling.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, once the economic policy is bringing countries in knees, then, you know,
I put it here like human rights. I think democracy, but of course, human dignity, so to say, should be understood as the foundation of human rights. And of course, you have to bring that into the equation. And that is basically the whole message I have, so to say. And we cannot get beyond these conflicts of immanence and differentiation. They will always prevail somewhere, but we can have a structured debate that somehow rationalizes these conflicts if we get a full picture of the relevant principles applicable and of their contingencies in the fields of economic and law. So just to conclude that, my ultimate call is more and more principled debate. Let's not understand law, and let's also teach convey the idea that law is not a stop sign. It's not a narrow black letter discipline, but it's something that normally, in hard cases, shows a high level of flexibility, amenability to context, contextuality, and an orientation by principles, whatever the methodology is that you espouse. I'm doing this well, none of us. I know you won't, many of you won't follow me on that, but I think there's also a diverging. That's probably the kind of differentiation that we have here in this talk. Thank you very much, and